Samuel Barber of Local Portrait. During this time, I will be highlighting various vignettes and compositions that span both his life and career. In about 55 minutes, it's impossible to wholly discuss both his life and career. So, as a result, many interesting stories and facts will need to be saved for another day. For this recital, I have chosen to stray from a more standard discussion of Barber's professional accolades, such as his two Pulitzer Prize wins and Guggenheim Fellowship, and into the more personal facets of his life, focusing instead on the man hidden in the shadows as opposed to the great American giant. As for the compositions, we will be observing select works, some that you'll recognize, and others, well, not so much. However, before we begin, I do have a couple brief announcements, the first of which is if everyone could please check to make sure that their phones are silenced. All of us up on stage, as well as your fellow audience members, would all greatly appreciate it. There will be a reception following this recital. It'll be right outside the atrium, straight through those double doors. And finally, I invite you all to sit back, relax, and I hope you enjoy this recital as much as I enjoyed putting it together. And so, without further ado, Samuel Osborne Barber II was born on March 9, 1910, into an affluent and well-respected family in Westchester, Pennsylvania. His father, Samuel Leroy Barber, was the town physician, while his mother, Marguerite, Daisy Barber, was a wonderful amateur pianist. From an early age, Barber's family understood that he was an incredibly bright boy, picking up languages quickly, reading voraciously, and was musically apt. So apt, in fact, that after 2 years of piano lessons with his mother, he composed his first short work at age 6, a 23-measure piece for piano titled Sadness. From that point onward, composition became a passion, and with the help of his uncle, American composer Sidney Homer, to whom he sent many of his compositions for critique, he began to develop his own unique style. Within this time, Barber discovered his love for the human voice, which isn't implausible, seeing as how his aunt, Louise Homer, was the leading contralto at the Metropolitan Opera at the turn of the 20th century. However, despite his musically gifted extended family, a life of composition and music was not expected of the young Barber, as his family, noting his intelligence, hoped for him to follow in the footsteps of his father, pursuing some cushy, high-paying job. Yet, by the age of 9, Barber knew what his destiny truly was, as seen in perhaps the most adorable letter I've ever read by a composer. It goes like this. Notice to mother and nobody else. Dear mother, I have written this to tell you my worrying secret. Now don't cry when you read it, because it is neither yours nor my fault. I suppose I would have to tell it to you now without any nonsense. To begin with, I was not meant to be an athlete. I was meant to be a composer. And I will be, I'm sure. I'll ask you one more thing. Don't ask me to try to forget this unpleasant thing and go play football. Please. Sometimes I've been worrying about this so much that it makes me mad. Not very. Love, Sam Barber too. You're the sweetest nine, it's the cutest thing ever. And so Barber continued his compositional pursuits. And in 1921, at age 11, he wrote his short piece, An Old Song. An Old Song, although not without its gentle faults, is a wonderful piece that gives great insight into the composer he would eventually become. In this piece, the audience is privy to Barber's close ties with his Scots-Irish heritage, a relationship easily attributed to the Barber family cook, Annie Sullivan Noble, an Irish immigrant who frequently sang Irish songs, played dances and jigs on the accordion, and told young Sam fairy tales in the kitchen. In this piece, you see her influence of Irish music and dance through the use of the 12-8 time signature, which is widely accepted across the pond as a time signature for a jig. Not only is this piece important in its relation to his Irish roots, but also in the sense that some of the elements song of the Charles Kings in an old song. Yeats's poetry is far more saucy, with an old woman gossiping to her three friends about old sword affairs. Delivers to the best of his ability. In this mournful, dirge-like setting, admirability, to embody a piece and its meaning. If the performer does nothing but reads notes off a page, the piece will fail. However, when the singer takes charge of the music, something truly wonderful happens. This piece also demonstrates the importance of collaboration between two instruments. With the piano part that establishes itself as low tolling in octaves at the beginning, the vocalist is forced to provide all emotional output themselves. However, as the piece progresses, it becomes a gentle yet jarring interplay between two voices to create its own living, breathing entity. And by the end of the piece, neither part is more important than the other, finishing it as it had started, with a single voice ringing out.
Upon our morning wall, the locks they are.
growth as a composer, or perhaps for accessibility. Either way, it's hard to deny the intrigue evoked by that piece. Our final Curtis era piece is perhaps his most widely known work. Dover Beach was composed in 1931 for medium voice and string quartet with text by Matthew Arnold. I would like to take a moment to emphasize his use of the word medium voice, as he intended this piece to be performed by not only baritones, but for mezzos and arguably countertenors as well. Dover Beach is an important piece because it showcases his ability to write not only for voice and string quartet, but to successfully combine the two. As stated by Barber himself in 1979, Dover Beach is a very difficult piece because nobody is boss, so to speak. Not the singer or the string quartet. It's chamber music. And despite the simplicity of the statement, it is extraordinarily accurate. With interplay between the voice and string, the interplay between the voice and string quartet is a delicate and purposeful dance that never lets either instrument overpower the other. A style that presents itself in many of Barber's works, such as the earlier Fantasy in Purple and later Knoxville Summer of 1915. All voices are equal, and yet the text is still delivered in a manner that rings clear and true. In this recording, which I will be playing momentarily, you will actually hear Samuel Barber himself singing the work along with the Curtis String Quartet back in 1937. Soprano and orchestra. In 1936, 2 years after his graduation, Barber embarked on the composition of some of his best-loved a cappella works, Opus 16, Reincarnations. The composition of the pieces took another 4 years, and he completed the work in 1940. As a set of three songs, with text by Irish novelist and poet James Stevens, Mary Hines, Antony O'Daly, and the Coolin revolve around the themes of love and loss. In the Coolin, Barber once again connects with his Irish roots, as the word Coolin literally translates from Irish Gaelic to mean fair-haired girl, as well as his love for the 12-8 time signature. In this piece, you'll hear a blend of homophony and polyphony, each used at specific sections for his ever-immaculate text painting. From the high, floating soprano to the low, earthy, resonant bass, it is in the hands of the performers to create the scene. I now invite you all to come with me under my coat in the Coolin. Such as this commando march, but the majority writing was left to the wayside. And between the years of 1942 and 1945, he wrote a grand total of 3 vocal compositions. A year or two after he had returned home, Barber was facing a tumultuous time in his personal life. While he was immensely grateful to be healthy and safe, returned from the war, in 1947, he found that both his father and his aunt were in failing health, and both would pass before the end of summer. Yet these factors did not stop Barber from composing one of his most beloved works for voice and orchestra, Knoxville, summer of 1915, with a dedication that reads, "In memory of my father." To be honest, there is no better text Barber could have chosen than that of the prose poem, Knoxville, summer of 1915, by James Agee. In this text, Agee takes a dreamy look back on the summers he spent with his family in Tennessee. Shifting perspective from that of a 5-year-old boy with a love and lust for life to that of an adult with an older, more jaded, cynical worldview. In the poem, he longed for the golden years that were so dear, while also living with the knowledge and understanding that humanity is mortal. Barber felt an incredible connection to this piece, as both he and Agee were the same age in 1915. Both were raised by artistic aunts and uncles, along with wonderfully supportive and loving parents. And both were writing a piece in memory of their father's relatively early passing. Neither his father nor his aunt lived to see the 1948 premiere of the piece. In this recording, you will hear soprano and commissioner Eleanor Staver with the Boston Symphony Orchestra performing Knoxville, summer of 1915.
One is an artist, he is living at home. One is a musician, she is living at home.
Thank you. margin musings, and decided to set a careful selection of them to music. Often returning translations until he received his desired wording or interpretation. However, it becomes political through the act of taking people we consider to be so different from ourselves on the margins of society and manuscripts, and humanizing them by talking about the desire to be alone, promiscuous women, and the camaraderie one feels with an animal. Although Barber related greatly to the texts, it is only in his 10th and final piece, The Desire to Hermitage, that he felt the need to write home to his ailing Uncle Sidney about, explaining that, no, he wasn't a hermit, but that he just enjoyed the solitude and silence. In The Desire for Hermitage, the audience is once again invited to hear a beautiful line in both the soprano and piano with a brief solo for the pianist in the middle. Once again, in connection with his wonderful cook, and she wrote the first act he wrote out, that was it, and she ran out of cream and juices, but that's fine. He had musings of a second opera following his graduation from Curtis, but it wasn't until 1952, when Barber was commissioned by the Metropolitan Opera, that he really began on his journey to complete his first opera, Vanessa. At this point in his life, Barber was facing some difficulty at home. He and Minolfi, although not split, had begun experiencing turmoil in their otherwise steady relationship. They had begun traveling alone more frequently and became more focused on their own works, something that, while not negative, did start to drive a wedge between the two men. Yet, this did not hinder their collaborative personalities, and although Minolfi's libretto was slow to fruition, as he had his own works to worry about, he completed it in 1954. In Act 1, Scene 1, comes perhaps the most well-known mezzo aria in American opera. Erica's aria, Must the Winter Come So Soon, is reminiscent of the Romantic era of music, with broad sweeping lines and gentle accompaniment, yet remains distinctly modern in the difficulty. Despite the easy-sounding line, incredible concentration from the performer is required, due to the fact that if one is unfamiliar with Barber, the rhythms and notes are anything but intuitive. But perhaps more importantly, there is an incredible emphasis on the performer's ability to set up a character with her wants, needs, and longings. This, as is the case for many other Barber works, is not only a piece about a beautiful line and a singer's ability to maintain it, but also demonstrates the performer's strong ability to act introspectively and to read between the lines. Barber, deciding that to have such a difficult aria solely in the head too much for any singer, excluding Schafer, to perform justly, removed it from every publication and performance following the Met and first edition. However, one recording does exist, featuring Eleanor Schafer with the Met Orchestra.
Twilight, fire lit in dark.
outside.